I welcome all of you bodhisattvas to the video. You're all bodhisattvas, actually, but Dharma kings, saviors. We all are already perfect. So we are just being reminded of that fact here. And if you're like me, you're like a spiritual orphan. You know, the great tradition of Western culture, for instance, is Christianity. It's kind of left us as orphans right now, which is a terrible thing. Because we don't, if we try to fit in with some other culture, some other tradition, we're not going to really fit. And this is what I realize. You know, it's just, so, wow, it's not good to be a spiritual orphan. Christianity has been undermined and termited. There's been a massive attempt to render it ineffective. So we're not, I'm not very pleased about that at all. So what can we do? Okay. What can we do? Now, what we're going to emphasize here is that one insight settles it all. Okay. This remains the emphasis because it is true. And it's astonishing. And in Christianity, this is the heart of it. They say Jesus washes your sins away and completely redeems you. They're talking about this insight that you have. And the shift to recognize, to see, you have no need to perceive. To perceive, you have no need to perceive. You've never had any need to perceive. And in seeing this, it washes all your regrets away entirely. Like, take for instance, like you have this white coat. And over the years, it's gotten so stained and dirty. And you say, well, it'll never be the white coat that it used to be. But then you take it to the dry cleaners and it comes back and it's like completely spotless. And it's exactly the same as you got when you first got it. And you say, that's a miracle. That's just, it's astonishing. I thought I'd never see it like it was when I first got it. And so you're just so thrilled by it. Well, this is an analogy for our spirit. We think that our spirit is all stained by these regrets, by these sins. Regrets and sins are pretty much synonymous, actually. Feeling that I somehow, I've been stained, I've been corrupted, and I'll never get back that purity, that pure feeling I used to have. Well, guess what? We certainly do. Just one little insight restores us to that pure feeling, the feeling of purity. Now, I saw this. I experienced it just briefly, and then I said, okay, continuity fear will arise. Okay, I know that. Fine. Don't struggle with it. It's like you see the sun, the clouds part, you see the sun, and it's still shining. You say, oh my gosh. And then the clouds kind of fog over a little bit again, but you say, oh, I know the sun is shining. And just one little parting of the clouds, and you see the sun is still shining in its purity. It's like that. Then what about all these teachings and empowerments and teachings? Oh my gosh, you know, are they needed? Ultimately, no. They arise because we think that we need more than one insight to settle it all. But the insight is essentially is, I believe, that it's along the lines of seeing, of recognizing that I don't need to perceive. That perception was never a need. It's never been a need at all. Now, you know, what do you fit this realization into? Do you fit it into Tibetan Buddhism or Hinduism or Christianity, whatever? It doesn't really fit into any of them, actually. It fits into the highest Dzogchen. You know, Dzogchen isn't pointing at anything. It it kind of fits in there, but there's not really a tradition where you can, stuff this into a tradition. Except pure Christianity, certainly, that's the root of it. They say Jesus washes your sins away, redeems you completely. This is if it's correctly understood, this is the heart of truth. But good luck trying to fit that into modern day Christianity, right? So we're kind of orphans here, spiritual orphans. And I keep complaining about that to the Dharma kings and saying, hey, this is terrible. We're in a terrible situation here, actually. On the other hand, you can say, well, it's good because since we can't don't fit in anywhere, we don't have to go believe we need all these teachings, and we can just say one insight settles it all. And I can't repeat that enough because it's absolutely true. Again, what is that one insight? Is it dawns upon you that perception has never been a need, never been a need. It has never been part of reality. God never had anything to do with perception, and it's not part of reality right now. We've never needed to perceive. However, we can perceive if we want to. God doesn't tell us you can't perceive. We're free, right? But it's never been a need. So we can still be in the world, but not of it, meaning use perception, but realize, always realize, we don't need to. There's no need to use it. So it's a different feeling, right? If you have something that you say, well, I can have this, but I don't need to have it. So you can set it down at any moment you want to. There's no need, no intrinsic need to it. Completely different feeling than if you think that you must have this. I can't ever be separate from it. I can't ever set it down. I can't ever. It's a completely different feeling. There's no fear involved. It just absolutely transforms your mind in terms of regrets and fear and all of that. It vanishes. Now we have a non-dual tradition in the West that's picking up some steam, so it probably would fit in there, as a non-dualist. Rama Maharshi has helped us out with that a lot. Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj, Puniji, there's various Hindu teachers that have helped kind of foster this Western non-dualism. Vedanta has helped to some extent, but it's really our own type of brand of new tradition, kind of this. So it might fit in there. I don't know. They tend to be minimalist as far as the books and the teachings and all that, and they just point directly at the directly, which is what we're doing here, is we're just pointing very directly that the recognition that perception has never been a need. And when this dawns upon us again, it changes our outlook completely. Therefore, you see, the body's never been a need. Things to perceive have never been a need. There's no need to any of it, actually. And yet it can still be there. Why not? It's creative. It's creative expression. So we don't have to get rid of anything. We just say we perceive that there's no actual need to perceive at all. But also, there's no need to not perceive. There's no need to perceive. No need to not perceive. We're free. We're free. Now, I had a face. I'm having a Facebook experience actually, which is just like very unexpected, very unexpected. I did all this posting of so many pictures of gurus yesterday for Guru Purnima, and some of my artwork and pictures I've taken, and just a massive outpouring of it, just to honor the day. Then I wake up in the morning, I've got like 120 notifications or something. I say, oh, well, okay, maybe some people are liking the artwork I do. And no, it's almost all from just one post I made. on Anandamayima private group, Facebook group, where I just said that I had this experience yesterday with this tremendous spiritual breakthrough. And the day started off by strong, strong symbolism and presence of Anandamayima. And by working all day with her pictures, etc., and focusing on her, I had this enormous breakthrough. And so I just told them, she's very essential, played a very key role in bringing about this tremendous spiritual breakthrough. And I posted there and said, there's no question that she is absolutely focused right now on our situation here with the trends of this world and protecting the Dharma, protecting her devotees, protecting the truth. And I absolutely, am certain, I feel very certain about this. So I just posted a little, comment and a picture and a comment. I said, I can tell you, everyone, that she is absolutely has our backs, and she, when the time is right, she will take decisive action. This is how I really feel this is true. This is her history. This is the history of gurus. They take decisive action just at the right moment. And poof, it's just like that. It's just very decisive. So she's going to do something to help us out. There's no doubt. No doubt in my mind that this will happen. So I just posted this picture, and people just it re reacted to it, extraordinary. They still are. I keep constantly getting Facebook updates of people liking this comment and picture. And it's like, wow. Hit a nerve. I didn't expect that at all. So you never know. And all the other stuff, but that this is what people, you can tell this is what they are desperate for. People are desperate for the gurus. They're desperate for them because they just feel like they're just getting clobbered. They're getting spiritually discouraged, which is the problem right now in the world. I said by the 24th of July, which is 3 days away, this is the tipping point for this world. And the tipping point is that spiritual discouragement will get so strong in the world that people will then turn to materialistic positivism or spiritual materiality, become spiritual materialists, spiritual positivism. And they will grasp at that. And that's what I say the yoga girls are the leaders of spiritual positivism, spiritual materialism. They're very good at it. Okay, give them their due. They're lined up and they're practiced and they know how to present positivism, materialistic positivism, in such a way as it gives you great hope that this will lift your spiritual despair. So it starts out because it's organized and it's glamorous and they really seem to know that what their business and it seems like it starts out strong. There's so many here to help you, like you're into a program and you're getting with it and you're feeling positive messages and all this stuff. So it starts out great, but it's where it leads you to. It's what's the direction and where it ultimately leads you to that you need to pay attention to. So this is the drama about to strike this world in a several days' time, actually. It's spiritual discouragement, and it's something so deep down you're not hardly even aware of it. But suddenly you will swing towards some remedy. You'll think, I gotta get a remedy. I gotta get a remedy, and these yoga girls, these women are very adept at presenting this spiritual positivism, but it's really materialistic spiritual. Materialism, spiritual materialistic positivism, spiritual materialistic positivism. And for many, 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 they will think this is the answer. This is the answer. And then turns into a mania and it starts sweeping everybody down the drain, right? So this is an extreme danger, actually. It's an extreme danger coming. For sure, it's the most extreme danger this planet has ever faced, by far, because we've never had this level of materialism by far. Nothing even comes close. Now, Men and women's experience in the world is different. Women are naturally more inclined towards materialism because of children, and they need to focus on getting surplus for their children. And men are less focused on it. They say, you know, they're not, you know, they work, but their minds, I mean, they're very different. Very, very different. And it's not a judgment. I'm just saying it's a pragmatic situation. Women have to, they don't have to, but they're the way that, you know, have giving birth and have the baby and the infant and all this, they're focused on how do I feed my child? They would feed their child before they feed themselves, most mothers. So they're all, they have to be very, very acute in terms of getting stuff and what deals are present. How can I, you know, and most throughout history, women had to be very shrewd and clever about how can I get enough food to feed my family, you know. How do I find the right husband as a good breadwinner? How can I structure things? How can I go, you know, to the market and get the right food and this stuff? And so they have to, they're very ha much have to be very smart on how to budget, how to deal with materiality to raise their children. And men lesser they tend to specialize in something. They try to make a living, make money and stuff, but they don't tend to be nearly as adept as women focusing on materiality and deals and coupons and savings and this and that. And women are very acute at this, very shrewd, very shrewd at materialities. But there's a big difference. Big difference. I saw a woman in a grocery store today, and her two kids were there. And she was shopping and looking at this and check. Okay, now what are they? And then she'd see, and then her attention to her children like this, and back, and attention to children like this, attention like this, attention, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. This is another skill that women have. It is they're able to have their attention dart here and there, here and there, here and there, here and there. But so. However, and men are less that way. You look at men, they're kind of, they seem to be able to keep focus their attention on something for a long time, and then they don't think about kids. Like from my life, I've never ever once thought about children in my whole life. Never even once thought about them at all. So there's an extreme difference. I don't think there's a woman alive that could say that. So I put all my attention on the spiritual path, and very little attention elsewhere at all. And so I can just keep my attention there without even any sort of idea of like, what's my 3-year-old doing in the store? Okay. So this is a huge advantage in terms of spiritually. It's a gigantic advantage. So men tend to have this advantage in terms of focusing on spirituality, a great advantage, because their attention is not distracted. If, especially those who don't have any children. I don't have any children, and I've never even once even thought of having children. So this just takes away a massive distraction from my mind. So today I'm driving. I pull into a parking lot, and I'm going to pull into a parking space, and suddenly this car, black Mercedes, just backs out real fast right in front of me. And I pull into the parking lot. I'm going like, you know, 10 miles an hour or 5, 8 or whatever. But you know, I'm going, it's a fairly nice sized parking lot. And I slam on the brakes. And I honk the horn. Say, whoa, whoa, whoa. Oh my gosh. If I wasn't paying attention, I would have, you know, T-boned her. It was a lady driving. And you know, I rolled down the window, and she's like, she says, she rolls down her window and says, sorry, sorry, sorry. I didn't see you at all. I didn't see you. Well, she didn't pay attention. She wasn't paying attention at all, and then she rushed off, you know. And she was, it was a store where you go in and you check all this beautiful interior decoration stuff, you know, how do you decorate your house, and there's so much things to go through, and it's just like a candy store, you know. And so she's thinking, you know, she just leave the store, her mind is on how do I decorate. My mind's never been on how to decorate anything. I could care less basically about, you know, what a house looks like. I don't care about any of that stuff. What my focus is on is on truth. So I don't care what the tile looks like in the bathroom at all. I don't even pay attention to it. I don't even care what my skin looks like. I don't even pay attention to it. So there's all these things. Keep in mind that the spiritual path is a play of attention. It's absolutely 100% a play of attention. It's the whole key. And that the Holy Spirit helps you with your play of attention. So the idea is to get your attention off all these distractions and focus on this fact that one insight settles it all. So this is this has proven to be extremely difficult for us here. Extremely difficult. So thank God there are some who are able to diligently focus their attention on this and get to this. Otherwise there wouldn't be any. And we won't even know it exists. And some women have done this, but mostly men have, because of this difference of simply being able to block out the entire world. I mean, I just think this is all I think about. And everything else is way, way in the distance. And you know, I just don't think about anything else. And my attention is always drawn to this. And this is what's required. You know, this is really required. Otherwise, you'll settle for spiritual materialism. You see, this is the danger. So it's not a judgment of women at all. And wise women will realize this fact. And they'll say, well, this is true, obviously. It's just obviously true, right? I mean, they do have to take care of so much with the children and thinking about their welfare and their future, how they're going to feed them, how they're going to pay for this, the schooling, and it never stops, right? It never stops, the cooking, everything. And the man might just be sitting there and they say, oh, he's lazy. Well, I'm sure a lot of people have thought that I'm lazy, but that's just exactly the opposite. I'm ferociously determined to block out all distractions and focus in on what is truly valuable. So that's extremely helpful to the world. And wise women will realize that. And they'll say, hey, men do have this advantage. And so why don't we listen to them and listen to what their advice is and hear it and benefit from it instead of trying to compete with it? You know, this idea of competing is stupid. So this driver, you know, it's just, I just realized, wow, is the materialism has overwhelmed women. This is what I know is true. It's not really their fault, because their whole habit throughout history is frugality, shrewdness. I've got to see what's available and then pick the best thing and sort it out and all this. But how do you sort through all this materiality right now? It's impossible. And yet they're still trying to. So they're overwhelmed by it. They're overwhelmed. If I was a woman, I would be overwhelmed by it. No question about it. I mean, it used to be you just desperately trying to find one pair of shoes. You know, maybe two. Now, you know, you've got millions of shoes to choose from. You go to Nordstrom's Rack and or just internet, whatever shoe stores, and it's just like, and they cannot, they're overwhelmed by it. Their psyche cannot deal with it properly. And again, not a negative judgment. It's just a fact. This materialism have overwhelmed women because they still think that they've got to find the best deal. They got to, oh, this is better than this. This is this. Well, what about this one? And we used to have like 5 tile samples. You go to a tile store and say, okay, now this one, this one, this one would go good, the color scheme, but I want the mood to be like this, but the texture of this isn't good. And then they got 5. Okay, I'll choose this one. I think this right. And then done deal. And she says, I made a great choice. See, women want to feel they made a great choice for their family. This is natural. And that's fine. They should. So they want to feel like they made the right choice. And so they're going to pay attention and make sure that they've looked at the options and made the right choice. So they feel good about it. That's very good. Now you go into tile store and you can order like millions of tile samples ultimately right now. I mean, basically you can get any tile sample throughout history, Egyptian, Greco-Roman, you know, Vedic, Indian, from any Byzantine, you know, Venetian, any sort of, you know, Taj Mahalish, Mughal, you can get tile from any era of the world now. And if they, you know, they'll make it for you, custom. I mean, the choices are virtually infinite, and getting more all the time. And it's this way everywhere. Okay, so we in the business I'm in, we deal constantly with wealthy women. And they are just freaking out. And everybody knows it. Okay? because they got too many choices. So their whole psyche is based on, I'm going to make the right choice for my family, for my children, for my husband, for the family. And so I've got to make the right choice. And yet there's a million choices. So they choose something, and then later on say, whoa, 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 wait a minute. And they can start second guessing themselves. Says, wait a minute. No, I should have gotten that one. Okay, I need to change. I got this one. And it's that way with every last thing about their house, about their clothing, about their appearance, about everything. There's too many choices. Food, vacations, everything. So their psyche is overwhelmed. It's overwhelming them. Now, this causes them to stall out spiritually. So what they do is they fake it spiritually. They bluff it, bluster. And this is what feminism is. It's spiritual materialism and the bluff of saying, hey, don't you, you know, I'm just as good as you. Anything you can do, I can do better. And they come on to the men like, you know, spiritually, like they know better. When in fact, they're just bluffing. They're just bluffing because they haven't had the time to focus their attention on all this. I spent my entire life focused on this, 24/7. And so, you know, it's like a piano player. You go to a virtuoso and someone says, I play great piano too. I'm a virtuoso. So, oh, let me hear you play. You know, they play and you say, you couldn't even play in a dance hall with that. What are you talking about? Yeah, but nobody really knows the difference. Yeah, I'm bluffing. Well, you know, in spiritual matters, you don't want to bluff. Okay, that's not good. It's not right at all. And everyone notices this. If you're not good at something and you know it, and you're kind of ashamed, like, wow, I really haven't put in the practice, then you're going to bluff and you get blustery and self-defensive. It's like a student who didn't do their homework and didn't read the book, didn't do any of the homework, and the final is today. And they go in the classroom, they say, holy cow, I don't know anything. I don't really know. I just got to bluff my way. And finally, you know, if it's serious enough, they'll burn the classroom down. Geez, oops, I tipped over the old days, a candle, I left something through, I was burning something in the ash can, oh, it caught on fire, the classroom burns down so they don't have to take the test. And so I say radical feminism is like that. They're like, their solution is to set the classroom on fire because they haven't put in the time and studying that they should have done because there's too much doggone products out there that they feel they've got to be up on all these products. These catalogs, everything, they can't stop, you know. Oh my God, how many dishwashers are there? Oh, there's like 20 new ones out now. And refrigerators and you know, stoves, every last freaking thing that they have to deal with. There's like constant flood of new models and new innovations and not to mention all the clothing, which women dress up for other women, actually. They don't dress for men at all. Not really. And what they're saying to other women is, hey, you know, I can hold my man, so don't even try. Look at me. I'm pretty slick. I'm pretty beautiful. I'm, you know, well, neat and sleek and clean and beautiful. And, you know, I can hold my man, so don't you even try. Don't even think about it. So this is why in public women are always competing with each other in dress and ornamentation, all this stuff. Because, of course, holding their man is very important for their children, right? If there's no man, that's going to impact the children for sure. So they don't want any woman to steal their man. And women are notorious for stealing men, actually. If they think they can do it, they will. I know men galleys get blamed for that, right? But that's rarely the case. Rarely the case. It's... You know, it's the women say, hey, this guy's got a lot of money. You know, his wife doesn't really seem to, you know, care too much about him. Hey, I think I can steal him away. So women dress in ornamentation, present themselves to other women. It's an intimidation thing. It's saying, you don't have a chance. You don't really have a chance. My husband satisfied with me. I look beautiful. I take care of myself. And, you know, but if they start letting themselves go in certain ways, the other women start feeling, hey, you know, maybe there's something wrong in the marriage, maybe this, and they start, you know, they're very clever, very, very like huntresses, actually. So this is another factor that women have to keep up with their clothing and their appearance. And there's so many options now. So many options, it's just killing them. And literally, they're overwhelmed. This is the truth about the situation. And again, not a negative judgment, compassionate recognition here. Materialism is just a killer. It's overwhelmed women, and they feel they've neglected their spirituality, their spiritual path, the deep path. And they absolutely have. It used to be the women would read the Bible to their children, to the family, to the relatives. They were the heart of religion in the family, and they spent a lot of time during the day. They'd read the Bible, they'd study. Nowadays, no, they've been overwhelmed. There's too many choices in every last possible way. And how do we pay for it? And this, go, 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 go. So this lady, she didn't even have the time to look if there might be somebody. She said, I knew she didn't even look because I saw her. She's backing out. She wasn't really looking at all. She was in too much of a hurry to get to the next store. And she knew it. And she just like, I'm sure she got home and probably said, "Thank God that guy was looking, and he wasn't so distracted." I was singing a Beach Boys song, I was relaxed, and not in any hurry to get anywhere. And so, I would say to all the women of the world, at some point, you're going to say, "Thank God these guys were not distracted, and were not bullied. They stood up to our bullying and our bluff because they were able to get the truth, and the truth still lives here, in the world. And at some point, they'll want to get back to it. Right now, they're overwhelmed. So I've had to stand up to feminism, radical feminism, my entire life because they just want to push us out of the way. They want to push men, to the back of the bus and say, "We're in charge of spirituality now." And I say, no. It's a merit based thing. It's not, you don't just say I'm entitled to it because, I told you so. You can't say no. No, you got to draw the line there. Got to draw the line. And it, when you talk with spirituality, you have to honor the experts. It's all important. So you cannot have it being run on bluff and intimidation and lawsuits and all this bluster that feminists give men. Is it's you know that they're bluster, they're trying to bully because they don't know the answers, and they're pretending that they do know the answers, and because they haven't had the time to really really focus on it the way that an expert has to focus on it. An expert has to just make it their absolute center of their life, and nothing else matters really. And then you get to the fact that one insight settles it all. Very difficult to get to this. One insight settles it all. You have to be an expert and dedicated to see this, experience it, and say, indeed, what Jesus told us and taught us is absolutely true. And how do you do that in a materialistic society? It is extremely difficult. So, I and how do you stand up to the radical feminists in today's society? It's extremely difficult. They have an entitlement complex. But I saw that woman, she was a wealthy woman, and she was just like, I could see the shock in her face. And at the same time, she was kind of gave me this message, real quick spiritual message. She says, "I can't help it. I'm overwhelmed. Please forgive me. Please forgive me." And I forgave her. I saw it. I said, "Wow, they're really trapped. Women are very badly trapped by materialism. It's worse for them than it is for men, actually. It's an extremely vicious trap. Got too many choices." When I grew up, I was happy just a white t-shirt or yellow and a pair of shorts and some cheap tennis shoes or something. And I dressed like that for years on end. Same t-shirt, same shorts, same tennis shoes. I don't care. It didn't make any difference to me at all. I'm comfortable. What's the big deal? So it was very kind of monastic in terms of just the way I looked, the way I dressed. I don't. My room, is just, I don't care what color, just white. Make it just white, and if there's holes in the wall, I don't care. It makes no difference to me. How clean the room is doesn't matter to me. My bed sheets, the color, the texture, I could care less. My hair, I don't care. I don't how my hair looks. I don't care about my personal appearance. None of that stuff really made any impression upon me. And then when materialism got so terrible, I had to do some yogic practices of looking into all of this and seeing, is it possible that to get free of this? Because women basically say there's no possibility to get free of this. And so it's not fair to them to say that you can get free, because they say, we can't get free. So it's unfair. So you should drop, you know, this high recognition. And so I had to go through and look at it and see if it was possible. I found out it is possible. It is possible. I actually went through all sorts of sadhana, spiritual practice of materialism, to see, is it possible for women to get free, for all of us? And it is possible. It absolutely is possible. But it's difficult. It is difficult. That is true. So we cannot, since it's possible, and we have no choice but to ultimately realize that perception is not a need, has never been a need, we have to ultimately get to that when insight settles it all. So you have to keep the experts around who know this. It's supremely important. So I cannot, you know, be told to shut up and defer to women, you know, to feminists, and defer and say, oh yeah, you know as much as I do, sure. But no, I cannot do that. I will not do that. I will not do that. This is totally opposite of what we should do. And just like that lady today, that wealthy lady, I saw in her face, she seemed to say, look, please, please understand, you know, and don't, you know. There was a whole transmission. She gave me an entire transmission of the situation of women right now. And she says, I hope, you know, I'm glad you didn't hit me. And there's another lady in the store, and I told her about it, and she goes, wow, you know, you would have won that collision. And I said, yeah, but that's a situation I don't want to win. I don't want to win that one. Because I got a bigger vehicle, would have, you know, crushed her, but would have injured her, you know. And I'm thrilled I didn't hit her. So I was, you know, aware enough not to run into her, you know, which is a great thing. So I don't want to, you know, impact, you know, women negatively at all. I have no desire to win in that way. But in the same hand, I'm not going to be, you know, submerged in any way, as much as I can not be submerged. If that's possible, maybe it's not even possible here at this point, because they're bluffing so severely now, they're ashamed, you know, to call their bluff. They're furious if you call their bluff, because they say it's not fair, because they think that they've been overwhelmed and they'll never get free of it. And I can say you will get free of it. There's no doubt in my mind you'll get free of it. I've already worked all of that through for myself. And ultimately, grace is stronger than materiality. And it will pull you, it will attract you away from it. But right now, it's, again, it's a million times worse than any time in history. The materialism now is so insane. You know, you can't even hardly express it. It's so crazy. And it's just devastated women, actually. Devastated their psyches. Because they feel that they have to keep up and have to be current and have to know what's best and have to make the right choices. And how do I make the right choices when there's these infinite choices and new stuff's constantly coming out? That my grandma, she would make a great choice for her sofa, for this real nice one. And that was it for the rest of her life. And she never had to think about it again. How awesome is that? How much that freed her mind up, you see. She didn't have to worry about that stuff. Nowadays, whatever you buy, it's going to break in a couple years anyway, and there's new stuff coming out, you know, almost immediately that is better. Look at the iPhones, look at smartphones, constantly churning, oh, you got to get this new phone, you got to get this new phone. Oh, and so you see women talking, they're always talking about, it seems like, materiality. Like, oh yeah, I need this, and this, and this, and this, but what about this, and this, and this, and this, and this, and this. And this consumes their minds. I don't get a smartphone, because, you know, upgrade, 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 upgrade. I don't know how my phone is now. It's an old one. And there's no question of upgrading this or doing anything with it. I just make a call and then I hang up. That's it. So there's no distraction there. You see, there's no distraction of keeping up with materiality, keeping up with the Joneses. Women are under this enormous pressure to keep up appearances. Say, we're a happy family. You know, the husband's happy. The children are happy. Don't you come poaching here. And unfortunately, there's a lot of insecurity in life because people aren't happy. Nobody's happy. And so you've got to put up appearances and bluff, and women are good at doing that because they do it for the children, you know, mostly. Some gold diggers exploit this whole thing. But mostly women are doing it for the children, their children. So it's a very noble thing. But this materiality has cut them, like they're in the shark's mouth right now. Really, they're in the jaws of a great white shark. And they're just saying, oh my gosh, you know, what do we do? You know, how can we? So they try to put on airs that they're really spiritually sophisticated, and they're not. They're not, because they haven't put the attention into it. They're very good bluffers, of course, because they often have to put on airs in public to say my family's happy, I got a great marriage. You know, when their marriage is falling apart, they don't want another woman to know their marriage is falling apart, because they'll steal their man away and their money, steal the money away too. You know, and the support and everything. You know, they had to change the divorce laws and everything to account for the problems that materiality has brought here for women. So women are also very good at putting on airs of being more advanced spiritually than they are. And this is big trouble, because they want equal billing, you know. They say, yeah, I did this for 2 years. It's like unbelievable, you know, accomplishment. Like, what? So, you know, like that, you know, the experts are like they've dedicated their entire life to it. Massive constant effort their entire lives, and they haven't been splitting their attention all over the place, because you have to have sustained attention. You can't one second, okay, I'm thinking about this, and oh, then what are my children doing, or what do I need, you know, this, that, okay, I'll get back to this. You know, that doesn't work very well. You have to really keep your attention on it. So these are just facts. So again, the wise women will say, hey, this is right. This is correct. And so let's pay attention to the experts and listen to what they have to say. And do the best practicing and try to. And again, the best practice, the only one that works, is everyday practice. You can't do it just through a retreat, you know, once a couple times a year, and boat cruise, listen to some spiritual teacher in this. You have to do it every day. It used to be women read the Bible every single day, for hours, actually. You don't think, like Mary Baker Eddy, you don't think she read her Bible every day? You better believe she did, probably 8 hours a day, because she was kind of an invalid. A lot of women in the past spent tremendous time reading the Bible, reading what the saints had to say, paying attention to all of that, going to church every day, okay? Going to church every day. A lot of women did that. And this built up very, very, very good momentum and qualities in the family. And in by extension, the community, and by extension, the state, you know. And this has gone by the wayside, and now they're just, you know, bluffing. They say, well, yeah, I got to keep up with all the shopping and the trends and the fashions. And they're getting jerked around by materialism so terribly. You know, well, what can I do about it? You know, it's what can anybody do about it right now? It's a terrible trap. So it used to be that women knew more than men a lot about the Bible, about this, that, but they didn't know more than the priest or the pastor or the professional, the expert. They didn't, and so they deferred to them. They deferred to them. They deferred to the rabbi. As they should. The rabbi, the priest, the pastor, the holy, you know, the one who's focused on, the theologian, the expert, they are, you know, dedicated to getting the very best and clearest truth possible, and explaining in the clearest way, and adamantly giving the right advice, and so they get their experts at it. So the wise women would go to them and get that information, then bring it back to the family. The husband would also get it, and they say, this is what we're going to do in our family. Now, this is how it worked throughout history, and that's why there were many saints throughout history. The women supported all this. They were very much in the groove of humility and listening to experts. Now, every woman thinks they're a spiritual expert. Okay, and they don't listen to men at all, basically. They don't listen to experts. They say, no, we're women, we're inherent experts. We know everything. Which is, again, ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. It's a bluff. And so just like the student who doesn't know the test, burning the classroom down, the radical feminists want to burn down the world classroom, so to speak. They don't want any experts around. So they could claim to be experts and nobody can contradict them and say, well, it's kind of like, let's get rid of all the virtuosos so I can claim to be a virtuoso and nobody will know the difference because nobody can play better than me. So it's pulling everybody down to a lower common denominator so they can claim, well, there's nobody better than me, so I can claim I'm a total expert. And this is what's happening. This is what's happening. A severe problem. Very severe problem. And I notice it everywhere. Wow. Now, so let's shift gears for a moment here. Yesterday was Guru Purnima. It's an old ancient Vedic tradition of honoring the experts, the gurus, the experts, the spiritual experts, either male or female. I honor Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. There's never been anyone greater than her as in terms of expertise. You know, absolutely. And there never will be. She was a perfect expert. But that's extreme anomaly, okay? Extreme anomaly as far as women go, most certainly. But she's an expert, so I pay attention to what she says, very close, clear attention to what she says. She's been extremely helpful for my life, giving me right advice, very strict advice. But it's the right advice, along with the other Dharma kings. So we're honoring the gurus, honoring the experts. And what we were talking about is that post I said that you know, the gurus show up at the right time to help you. If the situation gets too bad, they show up at the right time. For example, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma would say that, she used the analogy about gurus. She said, why don't you help us out all the time? She said, it's like this. Like a mother and a child, and the child's outside playing. And the mother, she's, you know, maybe reciting the holy scriptures, reading scripture stuff. But she said one ear is paying attention to the children and the sounds out there. Okay, she's listening to them also, splitting her attention, really. And so let's say this child starts crying, bawling. Well, the mother knows, she can tell, the wise mother knows, she can tell, is my child really grievously hurt or did it just get frustrated? It's just like the play didn't go the way they wanted it to. Somebody took their ball away or whatever. You know how kids get hurt, their feelings get hurt, and they're crying and boo, or they get a little scratch, or they fall down, get a bruise, or whatever. And the mother doesn't run out there and do anything. She doesn't run out there. She goes, no, the kid's okay. Not a problem. But if the child really is in a desperate situation, like they've got themselves stuck, their neck is trapped in something, or they've fallen, they're bleeding badly, or you know, something that's really badly happened to them. They ran into something and hit their head, and they got knocked unconscious, and now they're really hurt, badly hurt. You know, they need help. They're desperate. They need help. Those screams are different. And the mother can instantly tell the difference. And immediately she drops whatever she's doing and boom, she's out there to help the child just like that. So she said the guru is just like that. You know, we're crying, we're saying, wow, you know, the world's so terrible, it's so lousy, help. You know? And we don't think the guru responds. And so what's going on? But when the situation gets really terrible and we say, this is an extreme emergency here. We are desperate. We are in danger of falling into spiritual materialism to try and deal with the spiritual discouragement we have. And that this is a catastrophic spiritual problem for us, which is going to drag us into many, many, many rebirths and suffering and misery and hellaciously lost in samsara, the vast ocean of some contrasting labels that is samsara, Maya, delusion, sin. We're going to get pulled down into terrible sin, and we are really scared about this. You got to help us right now. Those spiritual screams reach the guru, and they are poised to take decisive action to help us. They will take decisive action. So we were saying, how come Anandamayi Ma has not, you know, done what we hoped she would do? Well, They allow the situation to develop until we become more and more aware and aware and aware and say, oh my God, this is terrible. So we lose our overconfidence and we realize, hey, I need help here. I really need help. This is terrible. So they don't try to intervene too soon. But at the right moment, they will intervene. We know that Jesus told us he will intervene in these times. These are the times he was talking about. He will intervene. And so will Sri Sri Anandamayi Maharaj. He will intervene. And so will Longchenpa. He will intervene. Longchenpa responded to my call because it was a desperate call. And he wouldn't have responded unless it was truly desperate. And that he the call was a call of desperation. They say, we are desperate for help. And he showed up right away. Right away. He says, okay, I'm here. I'm here. And that's going to make a difference. I'm here and I'm going to make a difference. Yeah, he's absolutely confident he is going to make a difference, and he has. Big difference. I'm here to protect the Dharma, is basically saying, I am here to make a big difference, and I'm going in protecting the Dharma, and this is going to happen. And there's no doubt in his mind. He was very serious. He wasn't laughing or joking around. He was very serious. You could tell he was all business, grim determination, or it was. This world situation had his full attention, just like Jesus came back. I think April 29th, 2015, he said, I am back. And I could tell this world has his full attention because this situation with spiritual materialism is the worst, this catastrophe from a spiritual standpoint that we've ever faced and probably ever will face. Because again, we are in grievous danger of being led down the primrose path by these yoga girls of spiritual materialism, thinking that this is the answer to our spiritual discouragement. I'm in danger of it. Everyone's in danger of it. And I know it. That's why I'm crying for help. I said, I'm in severe danger. We all are. Because again, these spiritual positivists, spiritual materialists, they know their business. Okay? They are really adept at what they do. They're experts. They're experts in misleading us, you might say. And that's a scary thing because any expert is a daunting situation. When you run into an expert, it's very daunting. You run into a spiritual expert, it's very daunting. If you try to confound them, you feel like I'm in over my head here. So any expert is again, this is a serious situation. And if they're leading you in the wrong direction, that's a grievously frightening situation, actually. So I'm making every call for help right now. I'm saying, I said the 24th of July, that this is the day we have to get help here. Really rolling. We got to get it rolling. Whatever their plans are, I'm sure they have plans. I don't know what they are, but I'm sure they have plans to help us. So with that in mind, I had a situation arise today, and I was praying to the gurus, help us out, please. You take decisive action. This burden is too heavy for me. It's too heavy for all of us. We need help. So I'm in a situation. I had to get something, pick something up. Someone needed something, and I was sorting through. There had to be just a certain product, and all these products weren't quite right, And there was one product that was right, but it was super heavy. And I said, because I know, because I had carried it before, man, was that heavy. And I said, wow, this is really a burden for me. It's a severe burden. And none of the other products were correct. Only this one I found out that I finally realized that this the only one that will work. And somehow I've got to carry this a long distance. And I said, wow, this is going to really hit me hard. But I said, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? And right at that very instant, a friend showed up, walked up the stairs, and he just appeared right in front of me. I didn't even hear him coming. I said, "Wow, how you doing, man? Wow." He says, "Hey, how you go? How you doing? How you?" And we explained, exchanged pleasantries. He said, "What you up to?" I said, "Well, I got to get this product out, this thing out to somebody, and it's like super heavy, so I'm, man, this is gonna be a pain." And he goes, "Oh, let me do it." Stand back. And he walked right up to it, picked it up on his shoulder. He's a very strong guy, very strong guy. And he just carried a piece of cake and took care of the entire thing for me. I didn't have to lift a finger. I was just like, my mouth was just like open, like, what? I said, man, did you show up at a great time? And this confirmation of Guru's grace right there. I was in a tough spot with a burden, very heavy burden to carry, and this friend showed up precisely at the very moment where I realized I had no choice but to carry this burden, because none of the other stuff I had, which was lighter, I hoped these other products would be the right ones, none of them were. So at the very moment where I faced spiritual discouragement, at the very instant that I realized, wow, I'm going to have to deal with this and this is going to be a mess, that's when this friend showed up. To the very instant, it was the timing was absolutely perfect, and he just immediately took charge and said, you're not touching that, I'm going to carry that for you. And he took the entire burden on himself, and I was just like, wow, man, that is just stunning. So pay attention to your life and see how these things are working out for you, because it's certainly working out for me. Extreme evidence that the gurus are about to take decisive action on our behalf. And we think that we're going to have to deal with the burden of this world, okay? And pretty much, we know that, for instance, the United States, but this is a global thing, it affects the world. We know that Hillary Clinton is going to get the Democratic nomination, so you know it's a done deal. Okay, that's going to happen. But what we didn't know is if Trump was going to get the nomination for Republicans, because there were talks of blocking him and such, and people just think that can't happen. Yeah, it's not going to happen. But when it actually happens, and I think it'll happen tomorrow, Thursday, people are going to realize that we really are going to have this battle now, this ideological battle, and people really are divided and polarized. And whatever which way it goes, this is going to be just a mess and a burden going forward. Everyone is galvanized now and poised for, you know, it's going to get really heavy. We know it's going to get very, very, very heavy, and there's no sign of that going away. In other words, the liberals failed to crush the conservatives. They failed to crush them. Trump rallied them. Their hope was that they could crush the conservatives, and we could all just then be herded into the cattle cars of spiritual materialism, and everything would go pretty smoothly. Well, it's not going to go so smoothly now. And so we're facing this global problem of spiritual materialism. Global feminism is an extreme problem. Because it's just crushing men. It's just crushing them. I see so many crushed men now. I hardly see any men that are not crushed in some way. This is a fact. I helped two homeless men out today. I try to help a homeless person, a man or woman, every day. But it's 100-to-1 men to women. This is the way it's always been in history, actually. Because, you know, women take care of the children. They're shrewd. They tend to not end up homeless as much as men, and men just get devastated by it. They just get crushed. The world crushes men way worse than it crushes women, actually. And so I try to help a homeless person out every day, and I was able to help two out today. It was great. I had all these crackers and very nice, wonderful boxes of crackers of different types, and they'd expired, and so the rule here is get rid of expired stuff. I don't really care about any of that either. I never checked expired. I don't care if the crackers is, you know, for 5 years old, I'll still eat it. That doesn't make any difference to me. It's probably still good. And so I'm not really, doesn't matter. But anyway, so they expired. So we had all these boxes of crackers in a grocery bag. I've been carrying them around looking for a homeless person to give them to for quite some time. And the usual ones are always gone when I pass by that area. I say, wow. And so finally, there's this guy I'd never seen before. And he was just, again, I happened to go to a store. And get something. How this all turn out? I was coming back from the store, and there was a homeless person. This happened before. I had never seen him before. And he was walking up the line of cars like he's supposed to, and I rolled down the window. I said, hey, do you take food? He goes, yeah, of course. Yeah, absolutely I do. So I gave him the whole grocery bag full of food. It'll last him a month probably, that stuff, at least for nice snacks. Now he's got really nice snacks, you see. And so I just hope that people will help one homeless person every day. You know, if each one of us helped one homeless person every day, that would go a long way towards feeling better about ourselves and others. I mean, they're so grateful for it. And there, but by the grace of God, go I. And then another one, he didn't walk all the way towards me, and he turned around, went back. I said, wow, you know, come on, you got to. So the light turned green, and I'm going. Everybody, you know, everybody's pushing me, and I had these chocolate bars that I've been looking for giveaway also. Very good chocolate bars, because I got to stay away from chocolate. And I had him out the window. I was honking my horn, and he saw it. He goes, oh, okay. And as I'm driving, I just kind of passed him off to him like a football, and he grabbed him like that. I slowed down pretty nicely. And the car behind me, I said, look, you're going to have to slow down. And if one person misses the traffic signal, well, it's okay. You spent like a minute of your life waiting for a traffic signal because a homeless person got some food. You know, you can handle that. And nobody honked or anything. It was fine. It was fine. I just did it smoothly. So you have to find smooth ways to help, you know, because sometimes, a lot of times, you know, you're in a car and you got to find ways. You honk the horn or open the window, stick your hand out with money or food so they can see you, and so they can come and get it. And he said, thank you so much, man. Thank you so much. And he was so ashamed of himself. He couldn't even lift his head as he's walking down this line of cars. He couldn't even lift his head up. You know, he's so ashamed. He said, homeless and hungry. And you could tell the guy's, you know, he's gone upon hard times. But for a man, this is very shameful. It's very, to beg like that, I can't imagine myself doing that. You know, I feel so sorry for them. Yeah, I'd almost rather die than beg. You know, it's just, and many men do, they drink themselves to death or something. You know, just like, I can't. It's such a shame. You know, the women have deserted me, my wife, the family. I'm ashamed. I lost my job, and I can't support. And it's horrible for me. It's horrible. So you could tell, you know, in their eyes, you know, you just say something to them. They say, yeah, you know, keep your chin up, man. I should have said something. I don't do as good as I could. I say, hey, keep your chin up, man. No, you know, nobody's judging you. You know, it could happen to any one of us. It doesn't mean you're any lesser than any of us at all. You just keep your chin up and pray to God in the grace of God, and I'll pray that you know, you get your confidence back. You just treat them like that. My grandmother used to. She helped so many homeless men during the Great Depression. My grandmother. She allowed them to stay in her house. She turned her house into like a free boarding house for them, whatever they could pay. If they couldn't pay anything, it was free. She made meals for them. She fed them. I mean, the men were just destitute then, and she helped so many men during the Great Depression. My grandmother. Oh, I always respected her so much for that. And she didn't care about how she looked. She was a great high society lady, and she was schooled in the, you know, highest private women's schools. She was a lady, and she lost everything, and she pretty much stopped caring about how much she looked and stuff, at least on the surface. But underneath, you know, she still felt she was a grand dame. But she had a great education, upbringing and stuff. She was very sophisticated, very much so. I think her mother used to write to presidents and chief justices and stuff. She was very high society, and lost all my her husband was a banker, lost everything in the Great Depression. So she took in all these destitute men and helped them out, and she continued throughout her life of helping people like that. So you know, we try to help like one homeless person a day if you can. I try to think, okay, what am I going to bring with me as I'm driving around to give to a homeless person? You know, and sometimes I forget. If you don't, I don't have much money. I mean, I give them a dollar, you know, but even I don't have much many dollar bills actually. So give them some food, boxed food, or some sort of food, or sometimes a drink, sports drink that helps, you know, keep them hydrated out there in the sun all day, facing the shame of trying to ask people for money just to keep survive. You know, that's horrible. So, you know, go ahead and do that if it's helpful. Keep your mind on spiritual truth and the materialism of our times, and how people are getting left behind, and we're just getting devastated by so much actually. And God, you know, people say, well, they're going to go buy alcohol, blah, blah. Well, give them some food then, if that's your concern. You know, everybody tells you that. No, they got more money than you to blah. That's not true. It's not true. They're out there shaming themselves like this. No, men, most 99.99% of men are not going to do that. Yeah, there might be one reprobate, okay, among the bunch. So what? Does that mean you're not going to give anything to the other 99? This is crazy. I once was helping a homeless man a great deal, and I gave him some money, you know, as I was prone to do. And for some reason, later on, I went in a parking lot, and I saw that he had gone straight to the liquor store and bought alcohol, and that he was just killing himself with alcohol. And was I mad at him? No. Did I stop giving him stuff? No. This guy had a lot of mental problems. You know, he was a reprobate in some ways, and all sorts of stuff. He was a laborer. He injured his hand so severely he couldn't labor anymore. He couldn't work to support himself. I mean, this guy was so destitute and physically deteriorated. It was horrible. And I tried to keep him alive. And so I said, okay, he's trying to drink himself to death. I don't blame him at all. Okay. So that doesn't mean you stop helping someone. You know, he's just destitute and ashamed and wants to die. Well, at least give him some dignity while he's still living. And so this is helpful. These are good works. This is charity. This is Christianity. It's all religions. Is you help out those who are down on their luck, so to speak, because it happens. It happens to all of us. It happens to all of us. You know, you could be the next one at some point, because keep in mind, you will be reborn again and again and again until you realize that one insight settles it all, and you're completely redeemed. All your sins are washed away. Up until that point, you will continue to be reborn. There's no question about it. And you might not fall upon hard times this life, but in the next life, hey, who knows? Look at my grandmother. She was a high society lady, wealthy, had everything materially, and just, you know, living the great life, American life, and Great Depression hit, and she lost everything. Rest of her life was very tough indeed. Her husband died from the shame of it. It was so shameful to him that the stress killed him, because he couldn't support her and the family in the way they were used to being supported. You know, it was just he let them down. And it killed him, a heart attack. He wasn't very old at all, actually. You know, I think in his late 40s or something. Never recovered. He never recovered from that. It's real brutal. I mean, men have their pride. They're expected to be experts and to support the family. And if they can't do that, it, you know, shatters their pride and their confidence. So it's awful. So this world is a crazy place. It is a totally crazy place. Very few that know that one insight settles it all. A one simple little shift of your awareness settles everything, because you realize that perception does not need to perceive. We do not need to perceive. We perceive that we do not need to perceive. We perceive that we do not need to perceive, and have never needed to perceive. That wipes everything clean. Just like that. And we're saved. We're saved. We're saved. Christianity uses the term saved. They call it saved by the blood of the Lamb. This is just symbolic way of the Jews when they put the blood of the Lamb over their doors. The Egyptian plagues, they passed them by. They were saved by the blood of the Lamb. Well, all these regrets are like mental plagues. So what Jesus symbolizes is and told us is we can be saved from all these mental plagues, because those are the real plagues, he says. And they use the symbology of the blood of the Lamb to talk about this, is meaning there's one simple thing you can do that completely saves you from all mental plagues. And Jesus says this is repentance, is what you need to do. You know, they end up saying, well, no, we got to do a blood sacrifice like we're used to doing, because we're used to sacrificing a lamb and that saved us from, so we got to sacrifice you and then use your blood. But that's not true at all. It's repentance that is it. Repentance means to say that the belief that we need perception is pure arrogance, that God never told us, did not create us with a need to perceive at all. So when we repent, we realize that we made up perception, we made up this need. We have no such need. It's complete make-believe, and we've never needed to perceive at all. And this saves us from our sins, completely saves us, redeems us. A little fly went in my mouth, a little bug. Okay. Tart red cherry juice there. Okay, so you're getting this intense transmission here of encouragement. Every single one of us is exactly the same. So Christianity, the heart of it is absolutely true. It's just a symbology of it coming from, you know, a certain society. I've always had a very difficult time to translate it, because I'm not a business person. I'm not an agricultural person. My history is more artistic. I'm an artistic, creative person. So I don't really resonate with these business kind of, the way Judeo-Christianity developed it. A lot of the metaphors were agricultural. A lot of them were business kind of metaphors. And I struggle with that. It doesn't really resonate well with me. But at its heart, Christianity is totally profound and totally true. That they say Jesus saves. All you need is Jesus and you're saved. Well, what they're saying is if you trust in Jesus and repent, you are saved. So they ask you, have you accepted Jesus? And the blood of the Lamb, what is the blood of the Lamb actually? It's repentance. It's the real blood of the Lamb that saves. And this enables us to recognize that we've never needed to perceive. We were able to perceive that we don't need to perceive. There's no need to perceive. Nothing needs to be perceived. Okay? Nothing needs to be perceived at all. And then this completely frees us from all this burden that we've been carrying around. All the baggage absolutely liberates us from it. I know you might say, well, how is this possible? Well, right now, take my word for it. It absolutely does. Because all our regrets is based on the belief we needed to do this. And now we see we never needed to do any of it. And so we're not bound by it at all. We've never been bound in the slightest bit. Never. And then you're a saint. You've been redeemed. You've been saved. Jesus saved you, so to speak. You've been saved by the gospel of Jesus, which he brought, which is repentance. Explaining our sin is spiritual pride, arrogance. So Jesus taught us very correctly, very, very correctly. And we have got it, the ego has been attacking Christianity from the beginning, because it's an extreme threat to it, extreme threat to the ego. So it really has done everything it can do to distort it, to turn it upside down and backwards, and make it vague and fuzzy and confusing and superficial and all this kind of stuff. And it's still relentlessly on the warpath as far as that goes. And most Christians are kind of, have been intimidated. They really have. It's been brutal. It's been a brutal war. A spiritual war has been going on for quite some time. You might say almost 100 years, the recent one, like 100 years war against Christianity. And most Christians have finally been pretty much intimidated. They don't do anything in public anymore. It's just, I was going to let this car in. I saw someone put a blinker on. They were in a tough spot. I said, I'm going to let them in. I'm just going to stop. It was the traffic was stop a traffic light. But when it goes, I'm just going to let them in because why not? I'm feeling charitable. If more of us just did this, because they weren't trying to, I didn't feel that they were trying to take advantage of me, which many cars do, especially when when it's gridlock and you're going through an intersection, the light's green, and you have to stop before going through because the traffic's backed up all the way, and if you go, you're gonna be stuck in the middle of the intersection, right? So if your lane's backed up, you got to stop and wait, and maybe there's other lanes next to you are still going. There's still some room. So, what some cars will do is they'll go from the other lane, they'll go through the intersection, and then when your lane starts to move and you say, okay, finally I can go, they then jam into your lane like that. And that's the worst impoliteness you can imagine. That is just blatant hostility, really, to you. And so it's like, I hope people don't do this because this happened to me. It's like, wow, that's really something. So I said, I'm going to let them in. So I let them in. I said, you know what? Maybe they're a Christian. I looked, and then sure enough, from the rearview mirror, was a cross hanging there. And I said, well, good for you, good for you. I'm glad I let you in. That's Christian charity. Let's be more that way too. So good works are great, but without right theological teaching, they're sterile. Okay, it's sterile. And it's a problem with the church today. The theology, the teaching is all screwed up. You don't get told clearly anymore, really. The emphasis and adamantness and clarity is just not there at all. So basically, the Pope just says, look, folks, basically all we got is good works, so let's really get into that. The only problem with that is that opens the door to just mere positivism. And that is easily pulled into materialism and spiritual materialism, and you then get really lost, really, really lost. So let us here, we have the right teaching here, let us not avoid works, because we can be, at some point we might get pulled into it, say, oh my gosh, I got to catch up, I haven't been doing so much, and we forget about the teaching. So make sure that you do good works throughout the day. And so you don't feel like, hey, I'm really deficient in that. I'm not doing any good works. That's terrible. Let me drop my meditate, contemplation, listening here, and full stop in the wild practice to do good works. No. That's a big mistake. Don't do that. Don't do that. In no way, your practice comes first. Your practice comes first. It's all important. Otherwise, you won't know what you're doing the good works for, and how people can truly be redeemed. The message of Christianity is redemption. And they say, we're certain you can be redeemed. Well, that's true. It's a great message. You can be redeemed this instant, as a matter of fact. Any instant at all, you can be redeemed. And that applies to everyone. That one little shift of perspective is we all have, since perception is not a need. Okay. Therefore, we made it up and we can change its purpose instantly. There's no prerequisite whatsoever to do that. None. There's no hoops to jump through at all. Nothing. Nothing needs to be done except just decide that it is so, and then you will perceive that you don't need to perceive and and never needed to perceive anything at all. Including bodies, including anything. You'll still see the body, but what you'll see is you don't need to perceive the body. You don't need to perceive it. You don't need to perceive these things. You don't need to perceive the world. You don't need to perceive at all. You'll see you don't need to perceive. It's not a need. Now, the gurus, they realize we're in a drastic, catastrophic spiritual situation here. It's so bad. I can't even, you know, I don't even know how, I don't know how bad it is. It's beyond. Every day you say, oh my gosh, it's much worse than I thought. Because you keep thinking, well, things are like the way they used to be, and someone has goodwill, good sense as far as, no. People are freaked out. And it starts to show up in their driving, actually. They're preoccupied. They're too preoccupied for truth, for simplicity, for absolute simplicity, because this whole shift is absolute simplicity. Nothing else needs to be done at all. That's it. And you have to be able to accept this absolute simplicity and total one insight, one shift, one insight settles it all of it, completely settled. You have to get to that. And how can we get to that in our distracted, like materialistic lifestyles of this planet right now? So it's a disaster. But the people of this world, especially the women, are saying, you know, at some point we'll get back to it, but right now we're just overwhelmed by what's happened, and we probably can't get to it right now. So good, you know. But we're very grateful that, you know, that you'll be able to help us at some point when we are able to get back to it, really get to it, that the truth will still be present, or, you know, there'll be a way that this teaching can be very clearly presented, and we'll get back to it at some point. They will. You all will. They'll get. You know. You'll get back to it at some point. All of us will. It's right now. We're having great difficulties, and this, you know, we get discouraged, and then we go over to positivism, and, you know, think happy thoughts, and that's the answer. We can make this a happy world. No, it's not about making it a happy world. One insight settles it all. All regrets, all unhappiness, dissatisfaction, everything is completely washed away. And then you realize that I never needed a world in the first place. This world is just our hostage, actually. It's just a hostage, really. We're holding the world hostage. Set it free. Set it free. Okay? Because we don't need a world. Nothing. A world doesn't need a world. There's no need for worlds at all, actually. So this poor world, we've just been holding it hostage and saying, you're fixated as a world. You're fixated with nature, all this stuff. Set it free. Set it free. It's just a living light is all it is. Set the world free and realize you don't need to perceive it at all. Of course, if you believe you need to perceive, you need something to perceive, right? And so this world is what we claim. Is God created this world so we could perceive it, you know? No, it's not true. Set the world free from we've been holding it hostage by our belief that we need to perceive. So it's getting close. I think today's the 20th, is it not? Yeah, it's the 20th. It's gonna be the 21st when you're watching this. Holy cow. You see, the liberals think that they were going to just crush the conservatives and it'd be easy, and now they're realizing it's not going to be so easy, and they're going to be very discouraged, actually. So they're basically in charge of the world now. This ideology. So this ideology is going to feel quite spiritually discouraged really soon. Like, uh oh. You know, and they're going to turn to positivism with a vengeance. They're going to trot out the yoga curls very soon. And that's a scary thought, to say the least. It's the scariest thought. I don't know any scarier thought than that, actually. When the yoga girls are trotted out by the liberal positivists, this has everyone should be shaking in their boots, actually. I certainly am. I'm shaking in my boots so bad that I got up today and the bug just landed on me is this orange this beautiful bug insect with his wings open. I said, wow, I worked out Monday and today's Wednesday. I just did an enormous workout Monday. Wow. Super intense. I can't believe how intense it was. And then I realized the Holy Spirit wants me to work out today and setting everything up for me. And I said, really? And then it showed me what it wanted me to do. I got this insight by this, some car just did this crazy thing. I couldn't believe what they did. It was just like, wow, where did you learn to drive? They must not know the laws of driving here at all. It was hilarious. I didn't get mad. It was so funny. But then I realized, hey, wait a minute. Maybe the Holy Spirit's trying to tell me something. And indeed it was. It was so peculiar. Oftentimes, something's really peculiar. Pay attention to it. It's an attention getter. And so then I did a workout today, which was just transcended anything I've ever done. Maybe in my life. It might have been the most intense workout of my life. I mean, my heart was just going like, like that. And I was gasping for breath. And this went on and on and on. So I got my heart rate up real high for a long period of time. And wow. What a lower body workout and cardio workout and also core workout too. I mean, it just, and I did upper body early in the morning. So I just had this tremendous workout today. And I said to the old girls, I'm catching up with you. You know, I'm getting close. You're getting close here. Closing in on them. Yeah. They still got me, but not by much. Because I did something that was just amazing. You know, just amazing. So my legs are getting so much stronger. It's just, but I don't know how I'm going to feel tomorrow. So for me, see, you don't want to be shamed. Shame's a powerful emotion. When you're in the grip of shame, you make bad decisions. And you know, you don't want to be shamed materially. So I get a few things now. I've gotten a few things just so I could look materially, you know, kind of like I'm pretty hip and decent and whatever. I just feel like you don't want to get caught by the spiritual materialism. And you know, we're all going to get spiritually discouraged coming up. All of us. We don't realize how badly, but very badly. And then we're going to, of course, you're going to search for an answer for that. You have to. And the answer is either the right spiritual practice or spiritual materialism. You're going to go one or the other. And it's easy to be shamed into spiritual materialism. They might say, well, you're the problem, the reason why you're feeling discouraged is you're out of shape. Because you feel this discouragement and you don't really know what it is, but they know how to manipulate it. They know, hey, you're really discouraged and we can give you this positivist path. And initially it'll seem like it'll take you initially out of that discouragement. At least it gives the appearance of that. So if you're really out of shape, you're going to easily get pulled into, you know, this positivism, like, hey, maybe if I just start working out and get in shape, I'll be less discouraged. I'll feel better about myself. And it seems like it starts working for you. Or, you know, if I just dress better, if I just shop, you know, start buying more and shopping more, I'll dress better and I'll do a makeover. I'll look, you know, and I'll be more hip and cool. And this will help with my discouragement and make more money, you know, hang out with the beautiful people and pay attention to the celebrities. That's another thing. The celebrities, they act like they're helping people's discouragement. So that we've had this terrible celebrity culture going on, and it could get extremely ferocious coming up now. people desperate for some celebrity. They can, I can look like them. I can talk like them. I can know what's on their mind, what their views are. The POTUS is like a celebrity like that for a lot of people. Or the people in the news, the news anchors are like that. People look up to these for encouragement because they feel so discouraged deep down because they think perception is a necessity and they can't figure out how to get free of this ocean of samsara. Because they have no idea that we can perceive that we don't need to perceive, and that perception is not a need, and that we can still stay in the world and function, but just by perceiving that I don't need to perceive this car. I'm perceiving it, but I'm perceiving that I don't need to perceive. It's not a need. I can perceive it, but I can realize it's not a need as far as a spiritual, absolute spiritual need. No, it's a pragmatic, functional need, but not an actual spiritual need. They don't know that. They don't know it at all. So they don't know the spiritual answer at all. They're blind, spiritually blind. So they have this terrible discouragement. Like, I'll never get free of this terrible storming ocean of samsara. So they're desperate for encouragement and possibly something to help them feel less discouraged. So easily they can get into all sorts of vices, any drugs, drugs make you feel better for a little while or something, you feel like stronger, pound down an energy drink and you feel like, wow, I feel like a world beater suddenly. And so you fall into all these vices and then those compound, they have side effects, they don't last, you start panicking, you do more, and it's a downward spiral. Spiritual materialism is actually a very bad downward spiral. It's hideous, actually. That's why I worked so hard. I know how hideous it is. So for me, like, I'm getting in shape now ahead of time. I've got some clothes that have, some style to them a little bit. I can dress in a way that I feel like is pretty stylish. It's okay. It's pretty simple. It's simple, very simple, but just sort of, just dress in white, kind of, or just a few little things that kind of just make me feel like, well, I'm not like, lacking in, because they'll tell you, well, the problem is you just don't know how to dress right. If you dress better, you'd feel better by yourself. And I say, well, look, I dress great. I dress fine. I mean, and that's not it. I know that's not it. And I'm in good shape, so that's not it, because I know that still doesn't deal with the discouragement. So I'm not so vulnerable to that. I try to, minimize my vulnerability to what's coming, but still vulnerable. I still don't trust it at all. And they'll say, well, you need love, you romance in your life. So romance might become extremely big. You need to dance, you need romance. You need better shape, better clothing, better food. You need, all this stuff. Manias will arise. All sorts of manias will arise. And positivism will become just, the new world religion, actually. Spiritual materialism will become the new world religion. And people will look to these celebrities and these yoga girls who, become very much a celebrity, like Hillary Clinton. She's a big yoga girl, actually, and she could become like some super celebrity, like the savior. She's the savior, and she's guiding everybody, her and Billy, leading everybody into this wonderful positivist solution to our discouragement. And so there's all these issues coming, big time. But even though I've done all this, I still feel extremely worried and vulnerable. There's no doubt about it. Music, you get swept away by music. Like a tsunami, you get swept away by all these different waves. And it's, we shouldn't have to subject ourselves to this kind of pressure, actually. Because you feel like you're just being relentlessly tempted in this direction, that way. See, if you're super discouraged, like depressed, you're desperate for something to relieve that discouragement. Desperate for it. And so you're going to clutch at straws. You're going to go clutch at straws. And easily the yoga girls can sweep you away. Easily. Because they're putting all these tempting goodies, like all these cookies. Here's a cookie platter. Have a sweet cookie here. And we eat the cookie, you feel good for a little while, and then you get a sugar crash. And you say, what the heck? I feel even worse now. So We'll see what the gurus do. Another thing is eating right. They'll say, if you just eat, get this fad, aloe this, you know, this. Well, I do. I already do all that stuff, so I know that's not it. And I can say, oh yeah, I do that stuff. I don't need your help. I don't need your help. I don't need your romance. I do all these things already, and so yeah, I didn't. You know, don't sorry, but don't need your help. It's like that. Thanks, but no thanks. A yoga girl recently just told, oh yeah, you do cherry juice. Oh, that's great, but mangosteen's really the best. You know, you got to get the mangosteen, but you can't, it's really hard to find. You got to go to Whole Foods, get a mangosteen. I probably should go check that out, because that's a yoga girl thing. Look, they always have some new thing that you really should do, because that's going to take care of your discouragement. And you know, you got to be careful, because the whole mother thing enters into this, because, and you can't blame them entirely, because mothers are always trying to, if the children feel discouraged, they're trying to encourage them, right? Always. So here, you know, drink this, you'll feel fine. Or here, eat this dinner, this will really help you. Or, you know, let's do this, and this let me get you a new shirt, that'll help you. So they're always trying to figure out, how can I keep my child from being discouraged, right? Okay, so that's part of the female experience here. So if the whole world's discouraged, we're all very discouraged, women are going to say, well, hey, we got to help the children out, help the discouragement out by saying, look, do this, this will help you. So they always are going to have some suggestion that they think, you know, it's right. But a lot of it's just psychology, like helping their children. It's a placebo effect. If they just are very, very adamant to the child, no, this is going to make you feel better. Wear this shirt, I know this is going to make you feel better. They think that oftentimes this will help out, even though it doesn't help out as much as they think. Children are not so stupid. But there is a placebo effect. And so these yoga girls are very adept with this mother thing about saying, being very certain that I'm sure this is going to help you, no question about it, and you got to do this because mom says this will help your discouragement, and she knows best because you're just a child and she has experience. So I know what's bothering you, so do this. And this is their attitude. And you know, who can withstand that attitude? Who can stand up to that? I don't know anybody that can, really, except the Dharma kings. When mother says you're supposed to do something, pretty much you do it. Even if you know it's not going to help, I do it anyway. Like, you know, I just, you know, just to please her. You know, she thinks that she's being very expert, because if you don't, she might lose her confidence, and you don't want a mom to lose her confidence. So you say, sure, mom, I'll do this. And, oh, how do you feel? I feel a lot better. You know, it's great. And you're just lying, basically. And then she says, you see, I knew that would help you. And then she keeps her confidence, which, you know, you feel that ultimately that's a better thing than your mom losing her confidence. So children do all sorts of things to make sure their mother keeps her confidence. And mothers end up thinking, not knowing this, they think, oh yeah, I really am always right, because everything I do, the child says, yeah, you did a great job, mom. So I'm like a goddess or something in my knowledge. They don't know that half the time the children are lying. They didn't do a good job at all. They told them something exactly opposite of what they're supposed to do. Exactly opposite, you know, like the child just goes, oh my gosh, I've got to fake it. Like, yeah, that's just great. Yeah, thank you so much. Because if you say no, that was like the opposite, they'll say, well, really? Oh, okay, well, see if I help you anymore. That kind of thing. You can get that, right? So you're not ungrateful, huh? So the children realize that sometimes mom gets really upset and say, well, you know, I really tried hard for you, so at least you could be grateful, and it must have helped you some way. And then the child says, wow, she's really mad, I better, oh, yeah, well, yeah, mom, actually, it really was good, and a lot better than I thought, and yeah, you're right. And then the woman says, see, yeah, mother, oh, I was right. So you get this dynamic going. It's a very bad dynamic of this, you know, that women don't realize they bought into this belief that they can do no wrong, that they're always right. No, we're lying a lot of the time, absolutely lying. Men do lie all the time to women, say, oh yeah, this is great, is it, you know, yeah, sure, of course, I'm happy about this, of course, no, this is what I want to do. You know, they just don't want women to lose their confidence. Mainly because of the kids, if you lose your confidence, you become very ineffective. This is true. It's very true. So everyone tries to help each other keep their confidence. You don't want to lose your confidence in this world. So we lie to each other a lot, and women get this from their husband and from their children, and so they believe that lies, and then they get this self-image that they know everything and they can't do no wrong. And but when it comes to spiritual teaching, that this is not true at all. This is too important to play this game. You can't play this game when it comes to this stuff. This is too important, and you got to say no. You don't know what's right here, and you're giving the wrong advice. And so that's what I do. I see that this spiritual positivism is the wrong advice. It's terrible advice. And I got in a lot of trouble growing up because I was very honest. I wasn't willing to lie to my parents. And so I was the bad sheep. I was ostracized. I suffered horribly growing up because I refused to lie. If they did something that wasn't right, I'd tell them. I'd say, no, you did exactly the wrong thing there. And like, what? The other kids thought it was so good. I say, yeah, well, they're lying. Just, how dare you say that? What, you're very sassy. Wash your mouth out with soap. I got so much grief growing up because I refused to lie. I really refused to lie to anybody. And you're supposed to lie to your parents. They expect it. But they kind of believe that they're way wiser than they are. And if you punch or pop their balloon, let the air out of their balloon, they tend to get very angry because they feel they're losing their confidence. And they say, you don't want me to lose your confidence, do you? That's going to really affect you terribly because I won't even be able to go to work in the morning. And you say, and you get totally, I got freaked out. I said, oh my gosh, I'm ruining the family. So I thought, it was put onto me that I was the ruination of the family and that I was going to cause the downfall of it all because of my honesty. But I was just inherently honest. I couldn't tell a lie. It was just horrible. So I've had a miserable life because people expect to be lied to. They expect to be lied to here, but this backfires on them ultimately. And when catastrophe comes, like it's coming now, they're up a creek without a paddle, because they believe the lies. They didn't do the spiritual practicing. They thought they knew all the answers. They have no answers, actually. They're spiritually ignorant. Everybody's told them that they're not. They say, oh, mom, yeah, mom, dad, you really know what you're talking about. They're clueless. They're clueless, okay? And nobody tells the truth anymore, And so this is the hell that we're in. It used to be that the priests, the rabbis, the pastors, the gurus, they told the truth. They said, look, you're screwing up. You don't know how to advise your children. So that's why you come here and ask for advice. You don't just take it upon yourself, think you know everything, because you don't. You probably may be a lousy parent, Maybe you don't know how to spiritually advise the kids at all. And they would tell them this, and they would have to listen. The parents would have to listen. Nowadays, the parents don't have to listen to anybody. In fact, the children now don't. The children end up doing stuff that's bad for themselves and indulging themselves, and they refuse to accept any discipline. Because of the times that parents are right, a lot is a lot of times discipline and good work habits, etc. And so tell the kid, don't be so lazy. Come on, you got to work. They're right about that. And we may not like it, but deep down we say, you know what? They're right. They're right about that. And when you do bad stuff, sometimes you get punished, and they're right about that sometimes. Sometimes you got set up, actually. And someone sets you up, and you take the punishment that someone else cleverly made you the fall guy. And so you try to explain to your parents, say, no, come on. So like, wow, can't win. So we all have problems with parents. There's no question about it. Great deal of problems, actually. Really, a lot of us have really bad problems. And some can figure it out and just lie, 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 and it goes smoothly, more smoothly for them. But then, they expect their kids to lie to them, and then they end up, being spiritually lazy. So I'm drinking the cherry juice because of that workout. I don't want to wake up with, like a corpse on my muscles. It's an anti-inflammatory. I don't take drugs. I don't take aspirin or Advil or Tylenol or anything. And it seems to work. I made a smoothie. So I drank that half of it before. It's got chocolate protein, whey protein, and banana and pomegranate juice. And then after I drink it after as well. As soon as I finished, I drank it, the other half. And that's supposed to really, really help your body recover from this type of workout. This workout, it's intense, and so I've taken it seriously. I'm taking it very seriously. I want you, I really tell, just telling you that it's worse than you know what's coming. The trap is of positivism is vicious. Most of us have already been preconditioned to fall into it. But remember, one insight settles it all. The insight, we can perceive that we don't need to perceive. And this totally redeems us, washes all our sins away. Instantly washes all our sins away. All regrets vanish without a trace, like they were never there. And they actually were never there, not really. They were make-believe regrets based on our belief that we needed to perceive. But now we see we never needed to perceive. Poof, our mind is just liberated. It's like a miracle, really. It really is like a miracle. It is. It's actually, there's a, it's a reason for it. It's not like contrary to anything, but it just seems amazing. Astonishing, actually. Redemption is truly astonishing. You think it can't be that simple. It is. It's absolutely that simple. And it's not anything other than that. That's it. Ultimately, liberation is completely simple. There's no way around it. Because it's based on a false need. We can't make the perception, we can't make that, make it that we need perception, but we can work, get free of our regrets about it. No, it's impossible. Can't do it that way. The only way is to see that it was never needed. It was never needed at all. God had nothing to do. We made it up. It was never needed. Only that liberates. We can never believe that we need it or needed it and reach redemption, liberation. Never, never, can never do it that way. Because then we say, well, why did God create us with a need to perceive? And then why would we want to get free of it? And, all these questions start arising. And we start distrusting reality in ourselves. And it gets very confusing, it's insanely confusing. So many try to be liberated in that way of thinking that, yeah, I need to perceive. I just need to perceive the right things, the right person. There you go. That's what materialism. Yeah. I'm not perceiving the right stuff. I need some new stuff. I need a new car. That's the problem. See how that feeds materialism? Who was working? A lot of people are working out today. A lot of different people were. Good to see. Everyone has a different reason, and you get these young people who are, just like 18 or 16 or something. They're still skinny and they're strong and they're light and they're, holy cow, it's easy for them. Yeah, you get these yoga girls too, who are like, young, or they weigh 100 pounds or less. They're, just great shape, light as can be. They just bump up, bump. Bump, I mean, just easy for them. There's some guy today is real big and heavy. I say, wow, that's difficult for him. But he was just sweating like a pig. I mean, he was just working out really intense, really hitting it. Like, wow, congratulations. Another guy was working out strongly too. And I had a talk with him, and his blood pressure had gone down. He had real high blood pressure before, and by exercising, it had dropped it down into normal range. And it's like, he says, I'm gonna keep doing it. I'm really going after it. And I said, good for you. All right, okay. So if we get discouraged, we might have high blood pressure. Then the pharmaceutical industry gets a hold of you, and it's a vicious downward spiral we're headed towards. And it may be so severe that we all have to sidestep it in some way. This is very possible, actually. Very possible. I asked Longchamp today, let me know. I mean, what's going to happen? What are you going to do? And as soon as I asked him, I went under this freeway underpass, and there was a car that had just stopped there and was off the side of the road under this, in the shade, under this overpass with the emergency flashers on. It was just staying there. And I said, wow. I mean, get off to the side in the shade. Stay in the shade off the mainstream on the side, and let all the traffic go by. So this was an indication of what may happen, is we may just have to step out of the spotlight for a while here. Keep a very low profile. Keep a very low profile. It may be that we have to keep a very low profile and just avoid, you know, avoid the traffic, the heavy traffic. Well, it's coming. It is coming. The attitudes are all there for it. You know, it's just like, you know, if you've got a yard full of dog poop, you know, you know you're going to get flies. The flies are coming. The flies are coming, right? Yeah, absolutely, you know. I saw this patch of water today, this little, and it was this full of mosquito larvae. And I said, wow, you know the mosquitoes are coming when you see the larvae, okay, larva. So the larvae don't look like mosquitoes. So you think, if you didn't know, you say, oh, that's no problem. So you look at the world right now, and everybody's in this larva stage of spiritual materialism. But very quickly, that they can hatch into the mosquito phase of full-blown spiritual materialists. And then they start biting you. It's bad. So I have to admit, I covered up this little pond with some dirt, some stuff, because there are hundreds of larvae, and they're all going to hatch and turn into mosquitoes and going to be biting everybody everywhere. And this, I usually don't do anything like that, but I said a prayer for them. I asked for forgiveness, and I said, but you're not supposed to have ponds of water like this. And you know, we have West Nile virus and Zika virus and stuff here, and so mosquitoes are not a good idea. You know, so I said, I'm very sorry, larva, but it's not usual for me to do that, but I did it. I usually don't harm anything. So I felt remorse about that. That's a tough one, really, right? Because usually I don't even kill mosquitoes if they're around, really. I try not to. But so that's a, you know, it's an interesting question, right? That's a moral dilemma right there. But I decided, you know, it was someone else's yard, and we were responsible for leaving that puddle there. And I there's gonna be hundreds and hundreds of mosquitoes from that, and they maybe end up getting bit a lot of times from it. And so it's my responsibility to, you know, not allow that to happen. But the analogy, well, actually, the larvae helped us out. So it was grace of God. The analogy is a perfect one. It is we're in the larva stage of spiritual materialism, most people in the world. But again, at some point, very quickly, suddenly, they metamorphosize from the larva stage into the flying insect stage, of mosquito stage. It can happen very quickly. Really amazingly quickly, the larva, right? How fast it can happen. So this is the trouble, and I'm saying by the 24th of July, the hatching stage is going to start happening, and spiritual materialists are going to start hatching all over the planet in large numbers, actually very large numbers, and we're going to start getting bit. And I was once bit by 180 mosquito bites one night in a tropical island, and I got stranded on the beach in a swimsuit, and clouds of mosquitoes descended upon me and bit me all night long. And I can tell you that was like, I would rather be dead than experience the torment of that torment. It was so bad. No way to treat it. I mean, it was insane. I just shivered and suffered hideously for days. So you get too bit by mosquitoes, it's bad. And when you start getting bit severely by spiritual materialists, it's real bad. It's real bad. You don't want that to happen. So you might want to go where there's no mosquitoes, right? You might want to steer clear of the spiritual materialists because they are very manic. They can get very manic and very demanding and very spell casting upon you, very much so. They just believe they're all great spell casters and you are already under their spell. So they actually practice this already thing, but in a negative way. They feel that you're already under their spell and you can't help it. So they just act like they just act like you are. And when you act contrary to this notion they have, you're like suddenly evil to them. Like, you must be evil to not be under my spell. Only the good people, all good people fall under, they think all good people fall under our spell. So if you're not, you must be a terrible person. This is how they think. You must be a really terrible person. It's kind of liberals. They think if you're not under the spell of liberalism, which is most definitely a spell, you must be a very evil person. That's the only reason why you wouldn't be. It can't be because it's a bad spell. No. It's a great spell, and all good people are under the spell. And if you're not, you're a terrible person. It's like that. It really is. And so this is a tough one for anybody. It just really works on your mind badly. So when it comes to right spiritual advice, moms are not the place to go for that. Never have been. Never have been. And never more so than now that they're not the right places to, right place to go for spiritual advice. You gotta go to an expert. So with the spiritual advice, it's all about experts. It's not about mom at all. She might be a master of all sorts of advice, but maybe an expert in none. But when it comes to spiritual advice, you don't mess around. You go to an expert. Got to. And again, that expert is not mom, nor is it a yoga girl. And it's not materialism. It's not positivism. It's none of that. It's none of that. It's really familiarity with non-dual teaching. This is the path. It's familiarity with non-dual teaching is the path. How late's it getting? Oh my God, I gotta get up early tomorrow. I gotta work a lot. Holy cow, not looking. Well, I look forward to it. Why not? Another opportunity for the Holy Spirit to help. So, again, we are focusing on the experts. We're trying to get clear, very clear, about what they're conveying to us. And we relentlessly work on this. One insight settles it all. Absolutely settles it all, and no other way. There is no other way to settle it all, because only this insight settles it all. Because this insight is literally that we perceive we don't need to perceive. We realize, and literally perceive we don't need to perceive. There's never been a need for us. And if you don't get to that, you cannot possibly resolve all your regrets, and whatever regrets you have. You just shuffle them and you'll compound them. They start being compounded and more intense. It's like you maybe only have 10 regrets, but they're fierce ones, instead of 100 ones that are not so bad. Whatever you want to shuffle it, it's still going to be a terrible problem. And suffering, 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 suffering. So we'll see how it goes. We'll see how the gurus play it, how they play their hand. But boy, are they getting me to work out. It is amazing. I didn't think I could do it. Holy cow. Body's in pretty good shape. Cardio's in pretty good shape. Everything's in pretty good shape. Except my back's aching. It sort of, for some reason, it brought something up, affliction in my back, but I don't know why. And of course, the yoga girls say, "Oh well, we have all sort, cure this, cure this." And the mom will say, "Oh yeah." So I never say anything that's wrong with me. I try to say, "No, I'm fine, I'm fine, I'm fine, I'm fine." I learned to just say, "No, there's nothing wrong." Even when I had walking pneumonia, I always say, "Nothing's wrong. No, I'm fine, I'm fine." I feel great. Even when I felt terrible, I said, "No, I feel great. No problem." don't want the advice, because then you fight over the advice. You know, if you're sick, well, you don't want to be fighting over advice and trying to explain to them why you don't want to follow their advice. You know, it's terrible. They should just say, "Okay, you want to follow advice? Okay, that's fine. Maybe it's not the right advice." It doesn't work that way, does it? People get very offended. You know, moms especially, if you don't follow their advice, like, "Oh, you don't love me," guilt trip gets laid on you. You know how it goes. You know how it goes. Everyone had a mother, so you know how it goes. So we'll see what could be done. Is speaking up is brutal right now. I mean, because people are just hoping that mom does know best because they don't know any other way. And that's they're hoping in vain right there. They're hoping in vain. You can see all the videos that I've done here. Every single one of them with full intent and effort and focus and determination to uncover more and more and more and more of what the problem is, to uncover it. It's very difficult to uncover it. Because who would think that it's perception itself, the belief that we need to perceive, that's the actual problem, that comes from our spiritual arrogance. Who would even believe that this could then settle it all? It's so difficult to get to that. But we have, but the effort has just been astronomical. But it's been done, and so that's, great, good shape because of that. I keep wanting to do lesser workouts. Like, can't I go, on a hike or, jog or something? And no, I got to do the toughest workout. Oh, man. I'll be able to, like, run up mountains pretty soon. I'll be able to just run up a mountain and get to the top and say, I feel pretty good. it's pretty cool to get your cardio going like that. It's like, wow. That's pretty good for your health, immune system, isn't it? To have your cardio, oxygenate yourself, be able to oxygenate yourself that way. And I don't know what's next. I really don't. Of course, probably none of us know what's next, right? Not exactly. Hey, my weight was pretty good this morning. Miracle. So maybe I can make my weight. I want to have a weight by the 24th. It's really important to make that weight. And I've been way above it, for a while now. And it's like, uh-oh, maybe I won't make it. But got a good reading on the scale. So I said, maybe I'm going to go easy on the food today, which I did. And maybe I can make that weight also, as well as, weight goals, fitness goals, nutrition goals, spiritual goals, all these goals, meet these goals, and then see what the gurus have for us in terms of their assessment of how dangerous it is to us, that the danger of us losing our focus and losing awareness of the truth. It's easy for it to slip away. It really is. It's very scary. We get so distracted, we completely forget. I've had this happen so many times. Right now I'm saying one insight sells it all. If you get pulled down into positive and hooked in that, guess what? If you get some romance going with positivism, guess what? A year will go by and you completely forgot, and then you can't even remember. I know I had some insight, but I have no idea what it was. No idea. Now that is scary, because this insight is extremely difficult to get to. And if you lose it, this is a disastrous loss for you. Just disastrous. So this is why the stakes are so high now, is we're getting now to the true core of it all. And to lose that, it would be a catastrophe for us. So I call upon the gurus more than ever to help us out so we don't lose this. It's very crucial. Oh, man. Whole body's just hit hard with the workout. It just hit hard. I must have a carpal tunnel in my wrist. It really, really hurts and sore, this whole tendon area. Probably from using the mouse so much. You know, yeah, I can't seem to get rid of it right now. Maybe carpal tunnel. I'll have to do something. Prayer, of course, is the first thing to do. So, you know, you could say it's interesting times coming up, but it's not really interesting. It's very threatening times. If you're a surfer and you realize that, you know, 30-foot waves are coming in, you might say, well, that's very interesting. That should be interesting. No, not really. You don't feel that way. Your heart starts pounding and say, this is very threatening. I don't like 30-foot waves. Right? No sane person would, unless they're specifically, you know, totally skillful in that, you know, these freaks of nature. But the average surfer said, whoa, this is very threatening. This is not really that interesting at all. I think I'll paddle into shore, actually. Yeah, if I was out there and the waves got big like that, you know what I'd do? I'd get into shore as fast as I could. You know, shame goes out the window at that point. If you're out in waves like 6 foot, 8 foot waves, that's big enough. And if you see some sets coming in, they're like 30 foot. You're gonna grab the first wave you can get in, you know, 6 foot wave, and you're just going to, you're going to just go straight. Don't even ride the wave, just catch it and just go on the back of your board. Don't even stand up, and then just bodyboard it in all the way to the shore, and then get the heck onto the shore and get the heck out. You know, get to higher ground. You're not gonna try to, you know, be out there like a scientist. How interesting! Let me measure out these waves. You know, I wonder how powerful these waves are. You know, well, they're 30 foot. You think they're powerful? You think? I mean, they're powerful enough to crush us. I mean, why, you know, do you want to measure like they can crush us 10 times over or 9 times over? I mean, you know, you think that's stupid. The scientists said, no, we need to know if it's 9 times or 10 times. No, we don't. I don't. If it crushes me once, I'm crushed. And that's the end of the story as far as that's concerned. So, get the heck out of there and let the scientists want to be out there and do what they do, let them do it. Let them measure if they want to. She said, gee, I wonder, you know, what's it like to be out here in 30-foot waves? Well, what it's like is you're likely to get killed, is what it's like. So that's what it's like. And some people are just, they're idiots, like those Pokemon Go guys, gals, nerds, and, you know, they're looking at their smartphone and they say, you're getting real close, and, you know, the smartphone shows them, go this direction, go a little more this direction, and they just walk off a cliff. They don't even see the cliff, just walk off a cliff. Social Darwinism right there. And what can you do? I mean, the social, you know, if people want to be part of, you know, social Darwinism experiment, that's their business. But you might want to, you know, take a look around. People getting hit by cars. I mean, this Pokemon Go thing is like, people are telling me it's really weird because they're not paying any attention at all. They think they can just walk out anywhere, and then, you know, the smartphone, that they're playing a game, so the whole world is like part of this game. You know, oh gee, a car hit me. What? There's no car in my smartphone. The smartphone didn't show a car, you know. How could it be a car? What, didn't show a cliff? How could it be a cliff? What can you do with those people? You know, you just got to let them, you know, maybe some hard knocks. If they want to be that whimsical. But for the rest of us, let's get the heck out of the 30-foot waves. Some people don't want to be rescued. They want to say, you know, be really, I want to see what it's like to not be rescued. This should be very interesting. Well, it may not be as interesting as they think. It may be very boring, actually, you know, to not be rescued. Very boring. It's pretty cool after the workout. I mean, the endorphins are so high, you don't really feel anything. And you feel kind of like you're floating, and you feel like, well, I feel great. It's got to be endorphins, because the next day you don't feel quite as great. But it's, yeah, after a workout, wow, if it's like an intense workout, you feel like slightly altered consciousness, and certain, you know, just kind of feel smooth and no pain, and you feel really, really good. But to get that, boy, do you have to really go through the burn. Boy, did I get burned in my legs today. I mean, intense burn. Like, I had to stop just for a moment and say, wow. Ferocious heat and burn in the legs, especially the thighs. So you know you're really hitting it hard when you get that. It's just, it's interesting. Everybody out there is in misery, shared misery, and you respect everybody there. You don't have to say anything or anything. Everybody's respected you when, because you know everybody's suffering the same way as you are, and you're working hard at it, and it's just, you know, kind of mutual regard, mutual respect. I feel that way. Everybody goes about their business and does their workout. Good for them. Tastes like grape juice, actually. Cherry juice could take this. Tastes a lot like grape juice. It's just got some tartness in it. Tart red cherry juice. Wash your sins away. Wash the aches away. We're going to wash our regrets away with recognizing that one insight settles it all for us, right? Which is perception of we don't need to perceive. Perception of no perception, you might say. Perception of no perception. Perception we don't need to receive. But need is the key word. Need. We don't need to perceive. That's the key word. Need is the key word. So let's not dispense with that. We don't need to perceive. We don't need to perceive. Okay. So just stay steady, practice every day, stay involved, stay excited, stay enthused. This is very compelling, right? Very compelling, actually. Counting down the days are getting so close. So just stay in this feeling. It's compelling. Stay with your good habits. Make a last burst of effort to make your good habits decisive. And then we will see. We will see what we see, right? We will see that we don't need to perceive. We'll perceive that we don't need to perceive. Ultimately, we will perceive that. We will. How we get there? Well, that's going to be a journey. The journey will happen, and it's happening, and it may continue. It really start happening now. When the Guru decide to take action, to intervene, something's going to happen. Very great. That's it.